I'm Bob Greenspan, and I wanted to invite you to watch this PowerPoint presentation, which will review everything you need to know about collecting medical antiques. You're looking at a fairly scary caution sign, since anyone who begins a hobby should do so with some caution regarding the personal risks, that is, the expense and the time. The PowerPoint is entitled The Charm and the Challenge of Collecting Medical Antiques, and this is a review. Again, I'll go over some of the cautions with an analogy. I'll tell you the rules of collecting. Why do we collect any antique and medical antiques in particular? How do you find and identify your instrument? How do you determine its value? Controversies in collecting. And finally, what to do now and when the time comes with your collection. Collecting anything can be addictive, so be prepared to answer these questions from your spouse and from your loved ones. Number one, why would you want to buy this piece of junk? And remember, anyone not interested in your collection will likely look at what you do in this manner. Number two, how much does it cost and how are we going to pay for it? And number three, where are we going to put it? I imagine that people's collections are a little weird, but yours are of great interest and importance. I'll use an analogy of corkscrew collecting, which actually is a very popular hobby. Christie's holds biannual auctions of corkscrews. There are over 100 books written on corkscrew collecting, and there's a very elite society called the International Correspondence of Corkscrew Addicts, and it's strictly limited to 50 individuals. Though there is a long waiting list with members from 18 countries, applicants must apply with a description of the size and nature of their collection to include pictures, a personal resume, and information regarding research and published articles related to corkscrews. Dues are $150 yearly, and there is a chaplain position on the board of directors. The reason for the chaplain may relate to the following quote from one of the previous presidents, Joe Perotti: corkscrew collecting isn't a life and death affair, it's more than that. And by the way, the president is called a right because the president would rather be right than president. Corkscrew collecting is a serious business and is primarily undertaken by folks who are interested in wines. That's why it's so popular. This is a David Letterman list of the top 10 corkscrews. There's a tie for number 10 at $20,000 each. These are the top five and the holy grail of corkscrews, which is the most expensive, over $35,000. I doubt if they would stand out if you or I saw them in a drawer, but to those interested in the hobby, these are the elite antiquities that are sought after. But again, this is true with every hobby. The first collecting rule is that you have to really set limits in your interests. Number one, you can't have everything, so set fences in terms of personal and financial costs. Number two, develop a theme and don't stray. That's the best way to start. And I like to define a collection either as a vertical or a horizontal collection. Below is a vertical collection. That is, lots of amputation saws, every different kind of an amputation saw. A horizontal collection would be the finest amputation saw, the finest obstetric set, the finest stethoscope, one example of every category. Whereas again, the vertical collection is all the instruments in any particular category. And number three, my personal advice is don't collect as an investment. The most expensive instruments may appreciate, but by and large, most don't over the years. So I would only enter collecting medical antiques if you really have an interest in history and in antiquities. Sir William Osler is a personal hero and is certainly the finest modern physician. I like to include a quote from Dr. Osler in this lecture to add some credibility to those who collect medical antiques. According to Dr. Osler, no man is really happy or safe without a hobby, botany, beetles, or butterflies. Roses, tulips, or antiquities. Anything will do so long as he straddles a hobby and rides it hard.
There are a number of reasons that individuals are interested in collecting medical antiques. The first major category is the enjoyment of the art, the beauty, and the craftsmanship. This is a second century bust of Asclepius, who was both the Greek and the Roman god of medicine.
Another example of the art of medical antiques is this 18th century wax anatomic model. These are very commonly found at the Spicola Museum in Florence. So if you're in Italy, that's certainly a place to visit. Prior to the 20th century, it was difficult to get anatomic models for dissection. So any number of materials were used. And again, this is just a wonderfully done wax model as an example of the art of medical antiquities. Physicians have used leeches to bleed patients for thousands of years. This is a wonderful example of a leech jar made of porcelain. It's called an Essex jar from the mid portion of the 19th century. This is called a Van Heuvel obstetric forceps. It's a destructive instrument that was made by Aubray, which was one of the finest French instrument makers of the 19th century. It was used to bisect the head of a dead fetus in order to save the life of a woman. So again, wonderful craftsmanship in order to make in order to produce an instrument that was used for a destructive purpose. This is another example of why collectors are drawn toward medical antiques. This exhibition surgical set was made by the Aubrey Company also and was used primarily for exhibitions and for competitions, was not meant to be used in the office. And all the instruments are handmade with gold, ivory, and blued steel. One of the aspects of early instruments that appeals to me is the irony of extraordinary instruments that are worthless and sometimes harmful, especially seen in a lot of the quackery items made prior to 1930 when there was no government regulation regarding what could be made and what could be done in medicine. An example of a wonderfully crafted instrument is this large electrostatic generator, probably made by Wagner. The patient would stand on the platform and would be treated with electric sparks and shocks that were produced after 24 glass plates were turned. Very impressive to the patient. The patient got a lot of placebo effect. Didn't do very much, but it was very impressive to smell the ozone and see the shocks and the sparks. Here's a picture of the large electrostatic generator in use, where the physician has an electrode treating this patient for a chest disease. And I'm sure she felt better after the treatment, whether or not there was any real therapeutic effect. I think most collectors are interested in medical history more than just accumulating instruments. And it's an understanding and appreciation of where the instrument came from and how it was used that really is fascinating. And I'll give you an example in the next few slides. This is the skull of a Union soldier who died during the Civil War battle at Cold Harbor, just outside of Richmond, Virginia. If you look under the right orbit, you can actually see the shot that took his life. This battle took place in 1864 when General Grant was attempting to capture the capital of the Confederacy in Richmond. And this was the last major confrontation between Grant and Lee. On the morning of June the 3rd, 1864, Grant's forces rushed those of Lee across an open field where about 7,000 Union soldiers died in the first 20 minutes. General Grant later said that this was the biggest mistake he had made during the entire Civil War. The next image was taken after that battle and is one of the most famous recorded during the entire conflict. This daguerreotype is called the burial party. The dead from the battle were hastily buried right after the battle. A year later, they were dug up to be sent back to families for a proper burial. And this again is one of the most famous battles of the entire Civil War. If you look at the skull to the left, it looks a little similar to the one that I previously showed you. Not to say it's the same one, but it's quite similar. Let me bring the battle a bit more to life through this letter. It was written by an 18-year-old Union soldier named Merari Stevens. He was one of many thousands of soldiers who charged across open fields toward Lee's army in an effort to capture the capital of the Confederacy in Richmond. Merari's father was at his side, though unfortunately was struck down and died in Merari's arms the next morning. Merari dug out the bullet from his father's hip with his Bowie knife and carried it with him when he later participated in the capture of Richmond. Merari wrote the moving letter you see, which is reproduced in my website, collectmedicalantiques.com. Several years ago, I received an email from a woman in California who had visited the battlefield and was directed to my website by one of the curators. It turns out that she is Merari's great-great-granddaughter and that she had the bullet. She sent me a picture with some follow-up, which you will see next. This is Harvey Stevens, and that's the fatal bullet that his son Merari removed on the battlefield of Cold Harbor. Following up the story, this is Merari sitting at the right with his sons. He became a surgeon after he moved to Ohio, practiced many years, and two of his sons also became physicians. Again, this is the reason many collectors are interested in instruments because of the fascinating history that they sometimes unfold. Another reason that folks collect medical antiques is for preservation of the instruments and of their history. George Thiemann is a German immigrant who came to the United States in 1826. He moved to New York City, where he started a surgical manufacturing company, which over the next 100 years became probably the preeminent manufacturer of surgical instruments in the United States and one of the finest in the world. 1876 was the 50th anniversary, so the company made this handmade set with mother-of-pearl handles and 50 rubies, one to mark each year of the Thiemann Company. By coincidence, 1876 was also the centennial anniversary of the United States, and the first World's Fair was held in Philadelphia, and this set was on display. After the fair, it disappeared for many years and was rediscovered in 1980. Fortunately, it is now known to historians and might have been lost had it not been kept for future collectors. This is the current display of that Thiemann set, and to its right you can see a guidebook book from the World's Fair, and below that is the medal that was won by the surgical set at the World's Fair. There are two admission tickets in the front, each of which cost 50 cents to get in to see the World's Fair, and between both tickets is a 50-cent piece that was minted in Philadelphia in 1876. So again, all these items are separate and are now brought together in a historical display. Electric corsets were very popular in the early part of the 20th century. We look at them now as quackery devices, but there were little magnets that were installed, and this is an advertisement, which are very common, but in my 40 years of collecting, I had only seen one. But fortunately, several years ago, I got a call from a lady who was cleaning out her grandmother's closet and was about to throw out one of these corsets and asked me whether I was interested in preserving it. So this is the Scott's electric corset on display, and again, would have been lost if there were not a collector to preserve it for future generations. Now to get into some of the common questions asked by collectors. First of all, how do you identify your instrument? You can look at period catalogs, which is probably the best way to go. Labels, hallmarks, The manufacturer will help you determine what instrument is and when it was produced, what materials were used. Is it a reproduction, a forgery, or could it be misrepresented by a collector or a dealer? I'll start with the example of this instrument. Is it a lithotomy or a bullet forceps, or could it just be ice tongs and not medical at all? Hard to know. Here's another instrument that looks very similar, and you could ask the same questions. So again, the best way to find out is to try to find the instrument in a catalog, if you can. The hallmark on the instrument was Tiemann, so I went back to an 1889 catalog, and on the right page at the bottom is the instrument, so it's this particular one is a lithotomy forceps, while the other one is a bullet forceps. Now the bullet forceps actually is labeled as a Weiss bullet forceps, a little bit of a curveball, but extremely rare to have an instrument labeled. This is the second instrument I've ever seen that had the purpose of the instrument labeled on the instrument. Generally, instruments are not labeled and can be very difficult to identify. Case sets are often labeled, and those labels can be very helpful in determining the date of manufacture. The example here is the Tiemann Company. Tiemann was located at 63 Chatham Street in New York between 1833 and 1864. In 1864, they moved to 67 Chatham Street, and then in 1886 and after, they were found at 107 Park Row. So looking at the address of the label can help you determine when the set was manufactured. On the other hand, the manufacturer may have the same address, but they may change their own name. For example, Robert A. and Colin was located at the particular address you see in 1867. They changed their name to Colin and C between 1876 and 1882, and then Maison Charrière after 1882. The materials and workmanship can be helpful. Very specifically, metal handles for sterilization purposes were found in instruments after 1900. Between 1880 and 1900, most instruments had metal handles, but ivory and ebony were found prior to the 1870s in general, and that can sometimes be helpful. The type that was used in the hallmark can be helpful, and again, going back to the Tiemann Company, you can see they used different types of print based on what years they manufactured their instruments. One of the first questions asked by collectors is, how do I find instruments? And the first response is to think about auctions. Christie's and Sotheby's used to have regular medical antique auctions, but neither do that anymore. There are auctions by major auction houses, but it's usually on an irregular basis, and you just have to check the internet and find out through advertisements when medical antiques are being auctioned. Probably the easiest way is through eBay and the internet. Fleaglass.com is a very good way to find instruments, as well as online auctions. Again, if you look at my website in the resource section, that's collectmedicalantiques.com, I have a list of all the dealers along with their email addresses. Number two, dealers and flea markets. Flea markets are really not helpful, and you will find out how rare medical antiques are after going to a few flea markets. You may see one tiny bleeder being sold by 180 to 200 dealers. Number three, purchase or trade with other collectors. This is the easiest and best way to do it. If you have something another wants and you can work out a trade, that's the easiest way to go. Most collectors don't sell, however. Here's another caution sign for collectors. Dealers and sellers sometimes don't identify their instruments properly, so you have to be careful. This is an illustration from the Miller Brothers cutlery manual. The top two instruments are often sold as surgical lancets or scalpels. Unfortunately, they almost always are ink erasers. Here are two examples from eBay. Both are ink erasers, but The left is correctly described, but the right is incorrectly sold as a phlegm bleeder. Notice the maker is Joseph Rogers. This company made tools and not medical instruments, and that certainly can be helpful in determining whether or not what you're contemplating buying is medical or not. Again, two identical instruments that are described differently. Both again are almost certainly ink erasers. The left one is described appropriately and the right is described as a scalpel. Occasionally you will see this type of an instrument in a surgical set or used as a bleeder, but most of the time not. Here's a 19th century surgeon who is proudly showing his case set of surgical instruments. Notice the amputation saw, and certainly medical in that it's in a fitted case, but a number of sellers market saws that were used for other purposes and not medically. Butcher's saws, carpentry saws, you'll often see sold as medical instruments. To the left, you see a saw that was sold as a surgical amputation instrument. And accompanying the advertisement was a page from a book written on medical instruments that shows a similar instrument that was a Tenon saw from the 19th century. If you look at the Distin catalog on the left and one of their saws on the right, again, identical to the instrument sold as an amputation saw, but again, you have to look at the hallmark on the saw, number one, and number two, see if it's in a fitted case to determine whether or not it was used medically. Here's another eBay example. These are advertised as midwife scissors for the umbilical cord. They're not scissors. They are ribbon clamps. Have nothing to do with delivery. So beware. They were used to clamp ribbons, usually after the baby was born, for presents, or to tie ribbons for other reasons. It can be even more difficult for collectors when reproductions are made of antiques. Now, this is a reproduction of a vaginal speculum that was made in the 19th century. So, in fact, it's an antique itself because it was made over 100 years ago, but it has a patina. This is a reproduction of the first vaginal speculum that was found at Pompeii. But again, is an antique, but not thousands of years old. Another question for collectors and collectors' families, in fact, what's an antique worth? Well, obviously, the older it is, usually the more valuable it is, how rare it is, what the quality of manufacture is. Provenance is extremely important. Provenance meaning who owned that particular instrument and does it have a history. The problem with provenance is it increases the value significantly, which is one of the reasons that I don't collect for provenance. And I think most instruments should be in museums when there is a specific history of perhaps a famous person who owned that instrument. A good guide is to go back to previous sales or auctions. They have auction catalogs that can help. And most importantly, the desirability to another collector or category of collectors. Medical antiques really don't have the high value that other antiquities do. For example, coins and stamps are extremely valuable because there are so many collectors who are so wealthy bidding. There aren't many collectors of medical antiques. Category of collectors, the value goes up if different types of collectors are interested. For example, medical books are very expensive because doctors and medical antique collectors like books, but book collectors collect books, and that jumps the value significantly. Some collecting controversies. The first, should I have an antique instrument cleaned? Again, these are controversial, and these are my own thoughts. Generally, the answer is no. You should not do anything with instruments because you reduce the value if you try to remove the original patina or do anything with cleaning them. And if you do decide to clean, make sure it's a professional who does that. These are second century Roman surgical instruments. And this is the way they were originally, and I think you would destroy the value. Also of note to apothecary collectors, I generally am asked what to do with the contents of bottles, and the answer is don't throw out the contents of bottles. That really destroys the value and the interest of bottles. Now, there are times when I have cleaned instruments. This is an early 16th century amputation saw, one of the earliest I've seen. When I got it, it was totally rusted over in horrible shape, and I sent it to a professional cleaner, and this is what came out, and I'm glad that I made that decision. But again, it's pretty rare for me to clean instruments or have someone else clean them. A final example, this is a 16th century lithotomy forceps that is for removing bladder stones, and it has the original patina, and again, I wouldn't ask anyone to do anything with this instrument other than to display it. The next controversial question. I have a case surgical set that has an empty slot. Should I add another instrument to it? And the answer is generally no, with several exceptions. And I'll give you an example. This is a wonderful ivory surgical set from Tiemann, manufactured at the latter part of the 19th century. Under that large amputation saw was a missing bone forceps. Now, these sets were handmade, so every little slot for each instrument was different. It took me over 12 years to find a bone forceps that I could add to the set. Now, again, my own personal rule is, number one, never to add to anything if there's prominence, because there's history, I wouldn't add to that. Number two, I would only add a bone forceps made by Tiemann that fit the slot, manufactured in the same time period. Now, another controversial area, should I have an instrument repaired or restored? And in general, I say not to do that, but there are circumstances when I have, and I'll give you two examples. This is called a Heine's osteotome that was manufactured about 1840. It's one of the holy grail instruments of collecting, a very complicated amputation chainsaw instrument. It was missing one of the guards. I have the original plans for the instrument, and I have an individual who is an expert at reproduction, so I asked him to reproduce that one small piece. Here are the original plans. In the upper left corner is that one piece I had added to it, and certainly when it moves on to the next collector, that information will be available. This is a Wilkerson dental chair made by S.S. White at the latter part of the 19th century. Originally, it was about to be taken apart for scrap, and fortunately, it was restored by an expert and now is in this shape. I think bringing this chair back to life is worthwhile and is one of the services that collectors do provide to future generations. Now that you've spent time and money on your collection, how do you enjoy your collection? What do you do with it? You can either display it or not display it. I prefer to display my collection and to share with students, with visitors, with other collectors, either at home or on the internet. I mentioned my internet site, and my collection is there, so it's a way for me to share. I lecture on the history of medicine and on medical antiques. I wrote and published a book on medical history, which contains lots of medical antiques. I lend instruments and illustrations. I teach medical students. And again, as an investment, buy and sell, I don't generally do that. It's not a good idea. Regarding lending instruments, one caution is I tend not to do that because these things are very fragile, as I've learned firsthand, and that's why they're so rare. So be careful if you do decide to lend your instrument. I mentioned that one of the ways I share my collection is through my book, and this is an example. On the left side is an amputation set and an amputation knife from my collection. On the right is a picture of how the instruments were used, and on the far right, an image of a collector holding a surgical set, which is quite similar to the one at the bottom of the page. On the left page is a description from a contemporary text of how the amputation was done. So my effort here is to draw the reader back in history and show them the instrument and how it was used. The final question is, what do you do with your collection when the time comes? Should you sell it? Should you auction it? Should you give it away? Should you donate it? A difficult question, and no one really has the right answer. The problem is that most places won't even accept donations because in order to accept a large collection, they have to provide space, security, and it actually costs them more to accept it for nothing. So it's a decision that you have to make with your accountant and with your family of what to do with your collection when that time comes. This is my website and this is my book. And again, thank you for joining me in this PowerPoint, and good luck in your collecting.